Hey guys, what's up? It is week 262, and to start this off, to let you guys know that the RoboTrix contest is still going on. If you want to enter, all you have to do is send an email to davidparker1986@live.com. In the headline, put contest or RoboTrix. I will add you in. I'm going to probably draw next week. Maybe the week after, but I'll probably draw next week. This is a Region B release, 88 films. It's a deluxe edition, still sealed. Really crazy, weird Cat 3 Hong Kong movie from 1991. Very enjoyable, sleazy, crazy action. And yeah, also if you do an iTunes or Apple review and you take like a screenshot of that or whatever, listen to podcast format, unless you're watching on YouTube, you know what I mean? But if you want to leave an Apple or iTunes review, take a snapshot of that. And I'll put 5 entries into the contest. So I will ship overseas, but I'm not going to pay for the shipping, and I won't be responsible if it gets lost, because international shipping has been really strange lately. So yeah, anyways, enter to win RoboTrix for, it was like the 5-year anniversary of the show. So yeah, let's hop into these reviews. And the first one up is from Dark Force Entertainment. And this is a bizarre one. It's called The Big Sweat. I don't know if I've ever heard of this one beforehand. Yeah, so it stars Robert Dazar from the Maniac Cop films, you know, the guy with the giant chin. It also is directed by Ulay Lamel, who originally kind of, you know, he started off, I can't remember, was it Germany? I believe he was a German director. And a lot of his early stuff, he always had a bad rep for directing really terrible movies. But I always remembered his first film, Tenderness of the Wolves. When I first saw that, I was shocked that it was Ulay Lamel, because he had such a poor reputation. And that movie's fantastic. He would go on to do The Boogeyman from 1980. And some other films, Prazi, a.k.a. Olivia. So as he went on, his career kind of got a little bit strange, and I would say that The Big Sweat is one of those kind of strange films. Now, this is an action film, and there is essentially, here's what they say, is extended ridiculously long 45-minute car chase, and that's in here. This is one of those movies that you would put in a category is made by aliens, similar to something like Hack-A-Lantern or Dangerous Men or Miami Connection. Now, I'm not saying it will live up to the hype or those movies, because those movies have a certain audience, and people love a lot of those or they hate them. It's kind of in that vein. So I was watching The Big Sweat, and I was immediately taken back at how strange the dialogue was, the style choice of editing, the coverage, all these kind of things. You kind of realize that this movie kind of looked kind of in a way like it was saved or patched together or some weird thing. Now, Robert Dazar is one of the stars of the film, and I enjoy seeing him. I really do. He's entertaining, and he can be really fun. He is such a bizarre character in this movie. He works for the FBI, but he does not act like an FBI agent at all. In fact, the leader of the FBI is such a weird kind of bizarre performance. Reminds me of something like Samurai Cop, the chief in Samurai Cop, who's just funny yet feels like he's in a completely different movie at times. But it's just such a weird performance from every actor in the film. The lead, besides Dazar, is a criminal who's basically got released from prison, and Dazar is an FBI agent trying to help him turn over on somebody else and whatnot. He also is carrying out a heist with his friend and his girlfriend and a couple other people, and there's some baddies that are trying to get, you know, they're involved in trying to hire him for it. But he's going to play a double cross on him. Like I said, this movie does have, and the back of the case says, there's a 45-minute car chase. That's essentially a huge chunk of this movie. It's kind of ridiculous and looks pretty dangerous, a lot of the stunts. It opens up, so you get a glimpse of the car chase, and then it actually takes place like an hour into the movie. I mean, we're like 50 minutes into this movie. The movie has no ending. There is no ending. It's unsatisfying, and like it's like, oh, they didn't finish this thing, or it's like potentially left open for a sequel, which is not going to happen. It's just a mess of a movie, but at times it is entertaining because it's ridiculous. The lead is awful. He is awful in this movie, and I don't know if it's the direction, the writing, the editing. It could be a number of things, but he has zero screen presence or chemistry, and his line delivery almost seems like someone's feeding him his lines or is reading them off the dashboard when Robert Dazar and him are going back and forth. It's just a lot of bloatedness at times too, and just scenes that don't seem to end and just go absolutely nowhere. Now, like you guys are saying, why am I tearing this movie to pieces? And like, There is that aspect of it, but at the same time, I think that people will get a kick out of how ridiculous the entire thing is. The lead hero is so terribly stupid that he double crosses these guys and then leaves his mom alone, knowing that she's going to get killed. And then there's a terrible death scene with her. There's no satisfaction of an ending for revenge or anything like that. They leave it open. The last 5 minutes of this movie, I know I'm spoiling, but there's not really anything to spoil. The last 5 minutes of the movie, you're like, oh, they're going to do something about it. And then it just ends in the credits roll. And you're like, is this open for a sequel or is this just saying we didn't have the money? Who knows? There's only one special feature on the disc. And, it's an interview with who was he? Production manager Jeff McKay, and he obviously mentions that the movie is fairly inept and not particularly good, and how he got hooked up with this whole situation and everything like that. And he talks about kind of trying to set. He used to work where he would sell movies to Germany and Japan and all that, and that's really interesting talk about that kind of stuff. Much more interesting than the film itself, but again, it does have that kind of I can't believe this movie exists kind of charm if anybody's ever seen that kind of movie. Like I said, the chief here is absolutely ridiculous in the movie. Dazar is chomping on a cigar the whole time. Nobody is acting like they're in the same movie. It's just, I don't even know how to go about it. Like I said, if I had to put it with something, it'd be like Dangerous Men, where it's just like, oh boy, this is just freaking weird and made by aliens and not really completed, and I don't know what the hell's going on. That's the big sweat. There's not really that much sweat in it. You think it would be like an erotic thriller? That's not really in here either. I don't think there's any nudity. And the only kind of sexual stuff we get is the main guy's partner kind of basically just groping a woman in the back seat, which is unpleasant and weird. It's just overall ridiculous. And like not purposely so, I don't think, but that is the big sweat. If aliens made movies, it would be this. Okay, the next one up is from the Twisting the Knife box set, the Claude Chabrol set, and this is Nightcap. And this has one of the regulars who's in a couple of his other previous films as the star. And this one, it has a lot of the same similar themes that he has, the deceit and the kind of like mental illness and all this kind of secret family stuff and kind of high class kind of stuff here. Boy, this movie is very strange and just a very bizarre set of circumstances in terms of the story. Not anything quite like it, to be honest. So essentially what we have here is these two different families. One is the patriarch is a pianist and his wife died in a kind of a tragedy. He's remarried since and he has a son. And the other group family is that of a kind of struggling young girl. She wants a woman. She wants to be a pianist and she basically lost her father. Her mother is a doctor, works in kind of like a lab kind of thing, processing chemicals, all this kind of stuff like that. And essentially what happens is one day she hears a story from a family friend that there was a weird mix-up at the hospital where she possibly was mistaken. There was a weird thing where the pianist actually, they might have thought that the kids got switched and everything like that. But she can't really help herself, so she goes and meets the pianist and they start a relationship, a friendship, and she pretty soon starts to learn from this pianist and learn some tricks and stuff like that and become like a pupil of his. But she notices something very strange about this family, in particular the pianist's new wife, who it's just such a bizarre but yet great and just perfectly done performance. How she's interested in this girl and how you are seeing like behind the scenes a little bit and just hints at what had happened previously. You kind of know exactly what's going on and you're just waiting it to unfold perfectly. And it does unfold perfectly and unfolds in exactly kind of a way you would expect, but just the little details are kind of unknown there. But it's just a really depressing and weird, sad story, but it has like the sense of realism to the tragedy or the crime that is committed. It feels legitimately very subtle but very detailed and real, if that makes any sense to anybody. But it's not overly graphic film or anything of that nature, but if it's such a it's so it's handled so well, this family tragedy or this family, secret, this dark secret or this crime, that you can really, when you go to explain something that happened in this dramatic fashion in everyday life, and nobody really can understand because it's so complicated. There's lots of nuances and stuff like that. It feels like it's all here. Like everything in the nuances is all in this movie perfectly done, if that makes any sense to anybody. But again, it's super well acted, super interesting too. And like I said, the characters are complex and the situation is complex. And again, it's a mystery. It's kind of like a, I would say, a murder mystery in a lot of ways. And it's dark too. And you kind of get into the psychology of some of these characters. All the acting is tremendous and interesting as well. Like I said, I feel like I'm repeating myself a lot with these movies, but all these movies share a lot of the same similar themes and stuff like that. And that's why like I said, his movies feel timeless in a lot of ways. And they don't really let me down. I think they're all really good. So the special features on Nightcap include a brand new audio commentary by film critic Justine Smith, When I Pervert Good, a brand new visual essay by film critic Scott Tyfoglia, which takes a closer look at the late period Chabrol through the lens of his masterful thriller Nightcap. Archive interview with Isabelle Hubert, archival interview with Jacques Dutonc, the behind-the-scenes featurette screen test for Anna Margolis, archival introduction by film scholar Joel Magny, and select scene commentaries by Claude Chabrol as well. So, yeah, like I said, it's so hard to rank these ones, but I feel like this is probably one of the in terms of script, I think the script is really well done, or the story and how it unfolds is really well done. So we have one more to go, and that is The Flower of Evil, and then we'll be all Claude Chabrol out for a while. So anyways, if you're a fan of his movies, I had seen, like I said, only one, The Butcher, and I really liked it before I watched these sets. But these have made me a fan, and like I said, these are like intelligent enough and well-made enough to really recommend to anybody that's into thrillers, as long as they get past subtitles, but I don't know why you'd be like collecting a lot of movies and stuff like that if you didn't read subtitles. Anyways, good set so far, and the last one will be next week. Okay, the next one up is kind of a favorite of mine, I must admit, and I had covered this on the channel before, but when I saw that there was a 4K from Vinegar Syndrome, I wanted to rewatch it, see it in 4K. This is Flesh Eater, directed by Bill Hinesman, from 1988. Bill Hinesman was the graveyard cemetery ghoul in Night of the Living Dead, the first zombie in the Romero universe ever see. He also was a cinematographer and still photographer. He did a bunch of stuff in the Romero group. He pops up in The Crazies. He also directed another film in 1986, I believe. It's called The Majorettes, which is kind of a fun, crazy slasher that turns into kind of an action thing at the very end. Cool movie. But Flesh Eater, it really is kind of an unofficial sequel to Night of the Living Dead. It has that Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania charm that is absolutely wonderful. It's thick regional horror at its finest. So I'm a huge Romero fan, if anybody doesn't know that. I'm big into zombies. I love regional horror films, so this movie was made for me. I originally saw this at a young age on the tape Revenge of the Living Zombies, and I always loved it. So Flesh Eater is cheap, it's low budget, it's got a lot of rough spots in terms of like the sound and some of the acting and things like that, but essentially what we have here is this guy's tearing up a stump, and he accidentally unleashes an ancient evil in Bill Hinesman, who appears to be the same zombie from Night of the Living Dead. That's right. He pulls this... it's so funny, too, because he's pulling this stump out, and he pulls it off, this big stump, and then there's, like, this weird, like warning and concrete and across all this kind of religious stuff, and he's like, "Why are these kids messing with my property?" And you're like, what kid, what college kid would go out of his way to put this weird, like, under a tree stump? What is this? So anyways, he accidentally unleashes Bill Hinesman. Bill Hinesman bites him in the neck and creates, like, this weird zombie plague going around this small town. So essentially we follow, kind of, I guess they're the main characters, these two people that are with this group of friends that are partying out in the woods, getting drunk, and the zombies attack them. And we've basically followed two of the survivors as they run from house to house. There's a Night of the Living Dead siege sequence and all these kind of small people, like these like small town personalities interacting with the zombies. There's an infamous Halloween party. I didn't mention it was on Halloween too, which is another great touch. Infamous Halloween party scene where basically the zombies invade. There's a ridiculous amount of gratuitous nudity. Like they somehow squeezed in as much nudity as they possibly could. Lots of breast and sexual situations and all that kind of stuff. And there's a gore gag. There's tons of gore gags. It cracks me up to look at this movie And it's kind of a low budget fun movie, and a lot of people probably pooed on it when it came out. You know, that's a cheap little flesh, nah, whatever. But you look at the gags per minute, and Flesh Eater has more gags in it in like 5 minutes than 90% of independent movies made now. And I'm not trying to bash a lot of new independent movies, but I'm just like amazed at how many gags and how much fun this movie legitimately had in it. Like I said, it's a blast from start to finish. It's a Halloween kind of little like lesser classic that I think people could really enjoy themselves. The score is very memorable, very synth. It just, it's always stuck in my head. I love it. And it has a Night of the Living Dead style, kind of round them up, shoot the zombies kind of deal, which I love. And of course, Vince is there from Night of the Living Dead, and he's getting real good at this, if you guys are catching my drift. Just really gory, and I guess some people could say at times it's unintentionally funny or a little hokey with some of the acting. There's a couple like familiar kind of character actors in here. The guy who runs the farm is in a bunch of stuff. He actually pops up in the final interview by Fred Vogel. Can't think of his name off the top of my head, but like I said, there's just a lot of people involved with this that had, you know, had a hand in Night of the Living Dead and stuff like that, or knew George Romero personally. And I think Bill Heinzman did an excellent job playing the Flesh Eater and directing this movie on a budget. It's actually pretty epic for a small scale movie, and it's loaded with features, and I had to make sure I listened and watched all the features on the new Flesh Eater 4K because they're freaking awesome. So we have a brand new commentary track by cinematographer Simon Manson and composer Erica Potnoy and producer Andrew Sands. Yeah, I listened to this one. It's kind of mixing with their interviews because they're all interviewed on here as well. But they definitely are pointing out people and having a good time. We have Zombie Nosh LLC, an interview with producer Andrew Sands. And I really like his interview. He actually plays the zombie. I bet the Dracula at the party, who has the over-the-top performance. And he brings up with basically being like a production assistant, I think, on this one. Like, is that what it, I just read it. I'm such an idiot. Yeah, producer. And like, he tells a story about originally, like, they're like, here's the producer. And he's looking around. He's like, where? And Bill Heinzman, you're not producer yet. He's trying to introduce him to people and stuff. That's really nice. And like, the one thing I will mention about this is everybody who talks about Bill Heinzman, they love him. They're like, Bill was so great. I still miss Bill to this day. And they say how much Bill helped them get in the movies, and how he was so, you know, understanding of people, how he's completely unpretentious, all about just making the movie and having fun and a family community style thing, which is awesome to hear, because I you feel the fun in this movie and you feel the family kind of stuff going on. And it got bigger and bigger, and like, it does have a little bit of that, like, you know, that what you think that Romero kind of style charm, where like you have this community coming together. And I think Romero probably made the best regional horror movies ever made, right? And I think that this has a little bit of that magic in it, and a little bit of that magic goes a long way, man. A long way for me. So I loved hearing that that interview there. Then we also have All Roads Lead Back to Flesh Eater, an interview with cinematographer Simon Manson, and he basically was also in the film. He does spend a lot of time in the commentary talking about when he had to like shoot the little girl, which is Bill Heinzman's daughter, who would go on later to play a zombie in Children of the Living Dead. Abbott Hayes, right? And then we have The Family Continues, remembering Bill and Bonnie Heinzman. That's always really difficult for me to watch. I love watching them, but she's talking about her husband and the movie and all that kind of stuff, and she worked on the movie. She's actually in the movie too, and so you're just like, that's kind of a bummer, but also super endearing at the same time. Carnage in Compositions, an interview with composer Erica Portnoy. And I'm going to be honest, the score is totally underrated and really, really fun. And like hearing her talk about it. And you know what? She seems to kind of, like at one point in the commentary, it's Brent Henderson's kind of moderating it. And she's like, it's just a little thing. And he's like, no, it's really great, truly great. And he's absolutely right about that. Family of Flesh Eaters, an interview with actress Heidi Heinzman. She talks about how he would go over to, I think, France and do the zombie walk and stuff, and how she ended up going to do it in his place and stuff. Just really touching stuff, like I said. Crushed Pink Grapefruit Brain, an interview with special effects artist Jerry Gurgley. And this guy did a bunch of stuff. I think he pops up in the Two Evil Eyes special features as well. But yeah, he did a lot of special effects, and his special effects on a budget are excellent. Like, I'm not doubting it. Like I'm not like for a low budget, the effects are amazing. And even for a good size budget, the effects are really good. And like I said, tons of gore gags. And they actually reveal this moment in there when there's this corpse who's been eaten down to like a puppet kind of thing, like a skeleton. And they show how they did that. And I never knew that was just like a little thing that they moved puppet. I thought it was a guy in a suit. For all these years I've seen this movie, I thought that was a guy in a suit, but really they somehow managed to do this just like flinging a head up, and it really got me. It looks great too. You rarely see somebody who's been almost eaten to nothing come back as a zombie, and you see it in Flesh Eater, so that's a nice touch. There's like a weird satanic magic feel to the zombie too, instead of your typical kind of, you know, unknown factor like the Romero films had. Then we also have To Live and Die in PA, an interview with actor John Mowood, and he's the lead in this. He talks about how he still misses Bill, and Bill got him the job and all that kind of stuff. Meatballs and Missing Actors, an interview with unit manager Paul Giorgio. We also have a minor budget majorette interview with hairstylist, makeup artist Terry Godfrey, extensive behind the scenes still gallery. I went through all these in one day, and I was very happy to listen. Like, it just was a nice touch, to be honest. So it looks really good in 4K, and I love that it's in 4K. I mean, it looks low budget, of course, right? But it looks really solid in 4K for exactly what it is. There is some hissing with the sound, but you can kind of expect that. And there's a lot of carnage, a lot of people getting eaten and stabbed and shot and killed and groped. Yes, there is a lot of nudity in here as well. But there's also a really funny story about Bill Heinzman in a French maid outfit that I'll let the special features tell, because they'll do it better than me. But there is a picture evidence of it. So anyways, if you've not seen Flesh Eater, I really recommend this kind of late 80s classic. It's one of these ones that's just a blast. It's just so much fun, nonstop, like kind of zombie gooey fun. And there's a funny little bit in here when they mention Film Threat. And you remember all the zombies in it too. There's not just like nameless zombies. Like, there are people that got attacked earlier, and you've seen them get shot and everything like that. You're like, oh shit, like that. And they pretty much make sure that they kind of get rid of all the zombies and stuff like that, except maybe possibly one at the very end. And there's a nice bit of animation as well, which I love. So anyways, Flesh Eater, highly recommended for Vinegar Syndrome and 4K. You need it. You need Flesh Eater. You need more Bill Heinzman in your life. Do yourself a favor and buy it. Okay, the next up is the Patreon pick, and this is from Jim Simon, and he picks Swing Kids. Now, Swing Kids is a movie that I actually had never seen. It was made in the 90s, and I don't even know if I've ever heard about it. But right when I was watching, I was like, this legitimately feels like a movie they would make me watch in school to kind of like over the Holocaust, over Nazi Germany, that kind of thing. So essentially what we have here is there's a group of kids in the, I think, late 30s, right before kind of like World War II would kick off. I mean, it's kind of happening this whole time, but you guys know what I mean. Well, I guess America got involved. Yeah, that's how westernized everybody. Oh, America, America. If it doesn't involve America, we're never, you know how it goes. So essentially, there's a group of kids, and they're obsessed with swing. So swing music. And it's kind of, a lot of these bands are banned in Germany at the time because there's Jewish and African-American people behind a lot of this music in America. They dress in British fashions, and they're kind of obsessed with American cult movies and stuff and all this kind of westernized culture. So essentially, there's a group of them, about three or four, that they kind of focus on. Frank Whaley is one. Christian Bale is one, very young. And the other kind of major actor here is like Sean Leonard. He's an actor that I've seen around, just his face, but I'm not too familiar with him. He hadn't done anything that I really knew. Christian Bale's really solid in this movie. He's kind of got the temper and everything like that. And Frank Whaley's also really excellent in the film. Also, it has people like Kenneth Branagh, Barbara Hershey. There's some other people that pop up. And Kenneth Branagh in this movie, he plays an SS officer. He is really good in here. So they kind of ditch the German accents. Everybody kind of speaks in like, you know, the American or English accent style thing. They always used to do that back in the day. Nobody wanted to have a German, German language or German accent, except, of course, the real bad guys like Kenneth Branagh, right? They always do that. So Kenneth Branagh is really excellent in this. So anyways, what happens is the lead, I can't remember his name in the film, he essentially, his father was taken away, and he's kind of like rebelling in this swing thing, but he's also interested in this stuff. And him and his friends don't really want to join the Hitler Youth. They don't believe in what the Nazis are doing exactly. And the movie is just kind of an interesting look at how Nazi Germany, like, basically just brainwashed all these people. So essentially, a couple of the kids end up having to go to the Hitler Youth thing, including Christian Bale and the other lead. And you kind of see how they're manipulated and slowly changed. And like, we start with this group of just like kind of young kids that are having fun and rebelling and maybe some little criminal activity. But by the end of it, you could see that some of them are starting to be completely changed over to the Nazi party. And there's lines, you get on Letterboxd, and people are just like laughing at some of the dialogue. When he says, "You're turning a Nazi." And he says, "Well, so what's wrong with that?" And people are like, "Ah, that's all stupid." And it's just like, look at today. People are being brainwashed all the time, and they say the most ridiculous shit. Like, I mean, honestly, people were brainwashed by the Nazis, and they actually, and you see the propaganda that they're pumping down people's throats and everything like that. And it's just like scary, but also always gonna get kind of, you know, resonate with society, because not a, when a society turns some way, a lot of times, you know, there is that moment, but there is that that point when, like, it looks insane and you don't think it could ever happen, but by the time it's happening, nobody really did anything and nobody wants to get involved and all this kind of shit. So, like, in a lot of ways, the movie really kind of, it landed with me in some ways. I know it has some cheesy dialogue, and sometimes when the characters just break out and, like, swing dance, especially the lead, it's like, oh, this is really kind of awkward and weird. And in fact, I don't know how I feel about the lead's performance. I don't think he's a bad actor. It's just a strange performance and a strange kind of actor in general. Wasn't too familiar with him. I think Christian Bale probably does one of the stronger performances, is because his character is just layered and very gray. And and that way. And Frank Whaley has a really good monologue, which is, you know, the right way to think, although it is kind of a sacrificial way to think in this situation too, you know, self-sacrificing deal. But yeah, and it also, like, it just, it can be on the nose a little bit, but also sometimes people need to see that, to be honest. So yeah, there is emotional moments, especially when he talks about his father. Like, it's touching. And I know, like I said, there was somebody on Letterboxd, I'm bringing up half Letterboxd reviews is half my review, but they mentioned, why do people hate this so much? Because they had to watch it in high school, and they, you know, and I really felt that kind of way too. Like, right when I put it in, I was like, this looks like something they would make me watch in high school. And like, I could see people hating on something just because they had, like, they had watched it in high school, so it's automatically goofy or bad or something like that. And it does have these moments of, like, shaky kind of acting or cheese or cringe, but at the same time, it does have these poignant moments as well. So I did enjoy Swing Kids. I thought it was pretty good. And like I said, the first 15 minutes or so, I was like, I don't know about this one. I really don't. And then as it progressed, I was like, yeah, this is pretty interesting. And I have not seen Christian Bale this young, so that was also nice. And like, Kenneth Branagh has been popping up a couple times here and there, and he was an actor I knew of, you know, from Mary Shelley's Frankenstein and other things. I just hadn't seen that much. And seeing him in this one, I was like, oh, wow, he's really good in this. Kind of trying to take the lead's family under his wing and whatnot, and kind of change them and stuff like that. So I thought that his performance was convincing. So that's Swing Kids. Okay, so if anybody follows 22 Shots, you guys will know that essentially we finished our 1994 retro year. We did our top 10 and everything like that, if you want to check that out. But now we drew the next year, which was going to be an 80s year, and thankfully we got one of the greatest 80s years of all time, 1980. So I kind of want to take this time to kind of just do a little introduction to 1980. I made an introduction for it, a little, you know, retro year thing that I do with some of them. And it's like 3 minutes and 30 seconds. It's too long, but I couldn't cut it anymore because 1980 is so stacked with favorites and cool imagery and everything like that. Of course, I used all Riz Ortolani songs. I mean, who could not? I mean, Riz Ortolani was the master of 1980. So if anybody can point out the 28 movies used in the opening, including visual, sound clips, sometimes both, maybe I'll send you something if not too many people can get it, because I don't know if anybody will be able to get all 28 with the clips and all that kind of stuff in there, and the sound. There's lots of weird little small moments in there. So basically what I'm going to try to do, and you guys can skip ahead to the reviews if you'd like, but I'm going to try to cover about 160 is my plan, 160 1980 movies. So you see a more horror, but maybe some like kind of horror adjacent movies as well that have kind of some name recognition that some people may consider horror. The thing is, I kind of want to go over the list with you guys so you guys can hear it and say, well, you're missing this or that or whatnot. And I can send you guys the master list I'm going off of. But I plan on covering all 160 of these movies. Maybe I'll miss a couple here and there. But so anyways, I have covered some of these on the show, and feel free to skip ahead to the reviews. There'll be timestamps. But if anybody wants to see this master list, let me know, and maybe you guys can follow along with me or suggest some movies that aren't on the list. But here we go. Altered States, The Shining, Cannibal Holocaust, Friday the 13th, Alligator, The Fog, The Changeling, Prom Night, Maniac, Humanoids from the Deep, Saturn 3, Cruisin', Dressed to Kill, Watcher in the Woods, Inferno, Eaten Alive, Death Ship, City of Living Dead, Terror Train, Night of the Demon, Without Warning, Motel Hell, Ninth Configuration, A House on the Edge of the Park, The Children, Mother's Day, Fade to Black, He Knows You're Alone, Anthropophagus, The Island, Hell of the Living Dead, Night of the Hunted, Contamination, Window, Windows, Schizoid, Nightmare City, Don't Answer the Phone, Zombie Holocaust, Dark Forces, On Scene, Boogeyman, The Awakening, Virus, The End, Devil Hunter, Blood Beach, Cannibal Apocalypse, The Hearse, Deadline, Christmas Evil, Night Kill, New Year's Evil, Beyond Evil, Alien 2, Unearth, Scared to Death. And remember, this is by Internet Movie Database's record. If it says 1990 in there, that's how we go. Patrick Still Lives, Demented, Macabre, Erotic Nights of the Living Dead, Primitive, To All a Good Night, Encounter of the Spooky Kind, Stage Fright, The Attic, Wolf Lake, Funeral Home, Cannibal Tear, Toxic Zombies, Legend of Sleepy Hollow, Blowjob, Witch's Brew, La Tia Alejandra, Godson, Dr. Heckle and Mr. Hype, Phobia, Island Claws, The Alien Dead, Lost Souls, Orgasmo Nero, aka Sex and Black Magic, if I'm not mistaken, Beyond Terror, The Cannibals, Night of Death, Monstroid, Zoom In, Rape Apartments, Hex, Beast Carnival, Catalysm, Terran Tor, Vengeance, Stigma, Zygor Elysian, and that's like a Seijun movie. I can't think of the Japanese director's name. I mispronounced that. Fiend, Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind, which is more of a thriller. The Exterminator, Aquella Casa en las Afueras, We're Going to Eat You, The Beast, The Savior, Mama Dracula, First Deadly Sin, The Last Hunter, Aliens Are Coming, Blood Rage by Joe Zito, Tomb of Dracula, Vicious and Nude, Sex Hunter, Terror Express, Madness, The Return, Crazy Thunder Road, Beast in Space, Curse of King Tut's Tomb, King Tut's Tomb, Haunted Tales, Sleep of Death, Savage Hunt of King Stalk, Moyer del Emilio, All Women Are Whores, Furiko Shinta, aka Writhing Tongue, Last Rites, Ombre, I think it's Shadow, and then the entire Hammer House of Whores set is there. So we have 13 of those: Witching Time, Silent Scream, Children of the Full Moon, House That Bled to Death, 13 Reunion, Rude Awakening, Guardian, The Abyss, Growing Pains, Two Faces of Evil, Charlie Boy, Carpathian Eagle, Visitor from the Grave, Mask of Satan. Then we have Savage Encounter, Bat Without Wings, Hexverse, Witchcraft, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, Trauma, Shadows of the Mind, Sabor, Asangre, Shaolin Hellgate, aka Heaven and Hell, Long Island Cannibal Massacre, Dr. Franken, Henderson Monster, Vahal Al Mas Allah, Tear in El Latro di Media Noche, The Medium, Bloody Lady, Horrible Honeymoon Tour, Wolin Nun Han, I can't remember what's the AKA name, Gilbert de Hexe, these all have AKA names, Forbidden Zone, Caged Women, The Happenings, Beast to Die, Stun the Nympho, Two Female Spies with Flowered Panties, might not rewatch that one, it's a Franco, Deserdera, Delito in Via Telada, Peppy, Lucy, Bomb, and Other Girls Like Mom, and Woman Avenger. Now, a lot of these are kind of like exploitation or thriller, but they have some name recognition that I'd like to stay. So that's a hell of a year, and that's not all of them. That's the ones that I feel like I should cover or possibly or I can get. I have a lot of them already, but that is the 160 movies I plan on covering for 1980, okay? If anybody wants the master list, hit me up. I'll send it to you. And, yeah, I guess we're going to get into... let's roll that intro.
They did this to you! They're trying to turn us against each other! Just look at them. What do they know about friendship anyway? I'll get them. You watch. I'll take care of those sons of bitches.
Watch it, Alan. I'm shooting. Oh, good Lord. It's unbelievable. It's horrible. I can't understand the reason for such cruelty. It must have something to do with some obscure sexual rite or
with the almost profound respect these women.
Getting very careless. Blood in your hair. What will we do? You want to look pretty, don't you? Pretty for me.
I can't believe you're not afraid.
All you have to do is piss on it.
Goody cat blood, ain't you?
God damn it, Ralph, get out of here. Go on, get. Leave people alone.
You'll never come back again.
Oh, shut up, Ralph.
It's got a death curse.
Evil.
God, my leg. God, my leg.
I'm here. You.
There's a fog bank out there.
Messenger of God, you're doomed if you stay here.
Demanding everything, including blood.
John, I want this material burned. All of it.
I ain't the crazy one. Remember?
In the lake, the one who attacked me, the one who pulled me underneath the water. Then he's still there.
Used servitude.
I think you will all meet again. In hell!
I'd have mercy on his soul. He was one ruthless son of a bitch.
Wendy.
Sally!
Darling, light of my life. Gonna hurt you. You didn't let me finish my sentence. I said, I'm not gonna hurt you. I'm just gonna bash your brains. I'm gonna bash them right the fuck in.
Well, Dad, are you proud of me now? Do I measure up? Huh?
My son was a son of a bitch, and he was no good. That's it, my son is dead. I don't want to talk about him no more.
I'll see. You're gonna die.
Alien! Mater Lacrimarum.
Ma'am.
Mater Tenebrarum.
We didn't find any boy.
Mater Suspiriorum.
You know as well as I do, it takes all kinds of critters to make
Farmer Vincent Fritters.
I wonder who the real cannibals are.
Okay, guys, the first one up from 1980 is Motel Hell. Yep, this is the Scream Factory release by Kevin Connor, who directed another horror film in From Beyond the Grave, which is an Amicus anthology, which is pretty fun. He also directed a lot of the Doug McClure movies with At Earth's Core and Land of the Dinosaurs, stuff like that. There's like four movies, Warlords of Atlantis, where he did like four kind of adventure movies with Doug McClure, who's in Humanoids from the Deep from 1980. And so it's strange. He's a British director, but he's directing like this American movie, and this movie takes place in America. It stars Rory Calhoun. That's pretty much the big name in here, who was in a bunch of westerns. He was an Angel. And Rory Calhoun gives one of my favorite performances of 1980. Let's start that out. So essentially, we had 1974 with stuff like the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. We had a lot of backwoods horror after that, Hexploitation. And so this one feels kind of like, in the same vein of that, Hexploitation kind of cannibal stuff here. But it has more of a comedic tone, right? It has that funny kind of tone, and I would say that's funny because when Toby Hooper made Texas Chainsaw, he said it was a comedy. Everybody's like, what? And then he would go make the sequel, which is completely off the rails comedy, weird stuff. But Motel Hell sits in that middle of Texas Chainsaw 1 and 2, and it has the comedic elements possibly, you know, maybe he was going for, I don't know. So anyways, what we have here is a young woman and her boyfriend are getting this motorcycle accident caused by Rory Calhoun. The husband is taken away, and I'll explain exactly what's happening to him later. But as she's kind of wakes up and sees like this Rory Calhoun and his sister, and she's kind of confused. They tell her boyfriend's dead, and eventually she starts to hang around this pig farm, which is where Rory Calhoun lives at along with his sister, and they slaughter pigs. But that's not all they're doing here. Right off the bat, we know that they're up to no good. Rory Calhoun's brother is also a police officer, so he starts to kind of take a liking to this girl as well. And weirdly, there's a love triangle between Rory Calhoun, this sheriff, and this girl, which is a very unlikely thing. Ida, the character Ida, is also excellent. That's Roy Calhoun's sister, and she's kind of like this bigger girl that's just absolutely really fun and great performance in here. Actually, on the special features, they talk about kind of like the different kinds of leads that would be in horror movies, female leads that would be in horror movies at this time. You have like the real pretty girl and then the real kind of like, I don't remember the three, but they say she's the different kind of type, the weird kind of strange type that's really different. It's a really kind of larger than life performance, very fun. Now, Rory Calhoun in this movie has such a really fun kind of like, demeanor about him. Like he's a businessman, similar to the cook, and especially the cook in Texas Chainsaw Massacre 1986, where like but Rory Calhoun's much more nice and charming, and he has like this good-natured quality about him where what he's doing is kind of in, like, he says it's for God, but it's also for a humanitarian reason and a nature reason. So essentially what they're doing is they're basically anybody that goes through on roads, they kind of spike the roads or hit the roads up. Anybody that crashes, they bury them neck deep and cut their vocal cords, and they feed them like livestock. And he looks at them as livestock, and he obviously is cutting them up and feeding them and selling the food. Hence, it takes all kinds of critters to make Farmer Vincent's fritters. So that's a kind of an iconic line of the movie. But anyways, the movie feels like it's definitely a carryover from the 70s, where we had that tonal kind of shift of like weird kind of silly comedy and stuff like Last House on the Left or The Town That Dreaded Sundown. It's still in Motel Hell, like these weird farcical moments of like, you know, sex comedy almost that don't seemingly belong here, like I said. Like, but in this one, the tone is a little bit more goofy, so it's like, I think that people will be able to swallow that pill a little easier. And I've always kind of like kind of adapted to the Grindhouse kind of serious, like goofy, like serious to goofy kind of switch, and I don't mind it. I like it. I mean, there's my bones cracking. But yeah, this one does have a little bit of that as well. And the comedy doesn't always like as a dark comedy as well, but it has the weird zany qualities as well. Like I said, Roy Calhoun and Ida really make this movie. I don't know the actress's name off the top of my head, but they really do. Their demeanor, their comedy moments. And like I said, it does have also kind of like some Eating Raoul moments, if that makes any sense, with a group of swingers. And there's just all sorts of weird, zany things happening. The end fight scene is excellent. It has the cover art right here, if you see that, with a pig-headed character and a chainsaw. So you kind of can guess what's going on here. It might have the best deathbed confession of all time, to be honest. As far as the features are concerned, there's new audio commentary with director Kevin Connor, moderated by Dave Parker, the director. New interviews with Kevin Connor, producers, writers Robert Jaffe and Stephen Charles Jaffe, actor Mark Silver. Interview with actress Paul Lynn and Roseanne Caton. Ida Be Thy Name, a look back at Motel Hell's frightful female protagonist, Ida Smith. And I like that one the best because it's just a lot of people talking about different kind of female protagonists and stuff like that. Or they call her a protagonist in that movie? I guess she is, right? But anyways, like the one downside of this movie is that the two killers in the movie kind of overshadow everything else in the film. And the idea of having people buried neck deep and cutting their vocal cords is something real haunting and creepy in this kind of weird, kind of silly horror film at the same time. You'll spot John Ratzenberger, I think his name, from Cheers, is in here as a bandmate. And yeah, there's some good gore gags in here towards the end of the film. It's not overly gory, but anyways, Rory Calhoun really is wonderful in the movie, charming as a killer. And it's strange, you'd never get something like somebody being killing people because, you know, there's too many people on the planet, there's not enough food. It's crazy that this kind of like down south kind of good old boy has these weird humanitarian reasons for killing people. That would never happen in a movie now. They definitely would mix that up, because I mean, even if you look at other ones like Hunter's Blood, they're poachers out there, and Texas Chainsaw, they're doing it as business only. But like Roy Calhoun has like this kind of higher calling to why he's doing this. At the same time, he wants to keep the costs low. Anyways, there's some really great moments in here. Motel Hell, first movie in 1980, did not disappoint on rewatch. I should mention that my Aunt Karen and Uncle Terry have always had a soft spot for this movie, and my cousin Jimmy. So yeah, Motel Hell is kind of one that I have an affinity for sure. So maybe I know people don't like it probably as much as me, or some people probably love it, but I've always enjoyed Motel Hell, and I always will. I think, you know, it's not perfect, but the bits of imperfection are canceled out by some of the stuff that I really do always remember and love. So yeah. And the next one up shows how different 1980 is in comparison to movies. And this is Encounter of the Spooky Kind, directed and starring Sammo Hung, who is a martial artist. And I've seen, I think, The Man from Hong Kong. He has a role in that. He's really good in that. But I'm not as familiar with Sammo Hung as I should be. And boy, oh boy, is he just awesome. So I think he came from kind of like from the school of like Jackie Chan, trying to learn from Jackie Chan and stuff like that, or do that kind of style of like comedic fighting and being a badass at the same time. So this is a first time watch for me, and it was one that I had to have right away. This is the second Blu-ray I bought, of course, of it though. So this is a really weird movie. Like it's different in a lot of ways. Like they said, it inspired stuff like Mr. Vampire from 85, which is a blast. And it is like, it's kung fu, it's comedy, and it's horror. And it has these elements of stuff like Evil Dead 2 down the line, where you have like these weird kind of fun moments of like, you know, monsters in a mirror and just playful action at the same time, and slapstick with the monsters and everything. It's not as gory as Evil Dead 2, but I guess let's get into the plot of this bizarre one. Sammo Hung is, I think he's like a driver, and it's a period piece, and he's kind of a buffoon, but he's really tough. They call him Big Guts or Fatty or whatever they call Scotland. Pretty rude. And he's married to this woman that obviously is unhappily married. She doesn't particularly like him. And he's always trying to catch her cheating on him and stuff like that. One day, she disappears and it looks like she's been murdered. And so, essentially, he's blamed for all these kind of, this murder. He's kind of put in jail and everything like that. But what we really know is happening is there is basically, his boss is basically sleeping with his wife, wants to kind of get him condemned and put in prison so they can get rid of him. But before that, we also have like kind of a V or Vi storyline where he has to stay the night in this kind of haunted house and he's dared for money and all this kind of stuff. And there's like an evil master wizard kind of behind it pulling the strings. And so we have like him kind of having to survive and fight this weird zombie and stuff like that. And there's a couple moments like this and gags and stuff. There's one earlier with a mirror that's really fun. So like we have that aspect of the movie, and I was so glad that wasn't just the movie. Like I was like, I can dig this, but that was just a little part of it. So like as it goes on, like later, there's another kind of master that decides to help him because he knows that one of it, his old master, what he's doing, he finds wrong. So he takes Sammo Hung under his like kind of wing, and he basically trains him a little bit, and which leads to this giant showdown between these two wizards, and it's insanely weird and goofy and funny and just bizarre. Lots of cool gags. I will warn you, it seems like almost every movie from 1980 has animal cruelty. Encounter of a Spooky Kind is no different. So we got a lot of dead chickens and stuff like that, which probably won't, you know, excite too many people. The stuff that I loved was Sammo Hung's fighting. Like there's a great moment where he escapes from prison and he has to fight these two guys close quarters, and he just boots this one dude in the chest so hard and he hits against the wall, because it's very rare that you get to see kind of a bigger guy throw down and throw down in such a believable, entertaining way, like the stunts he's doing and stuff, like because he's a stocky dude, like, and he obviously is very athletic, and it's just really fun to see him throw down with a lot of guys, because you don't typically see that. You know, you have your typical skinny or built guy fighting in these movies, and seeing him kind of throw down with everybody was just really awesome. Like I said, the ending is bizarre. Fires flying at each other and just weird spells kind of reminded me of, you know, obviously a less serious, more playful The Wailing, because that's a South Korean movie where they kind of use like this spells and stuff like that and controlling people and everything. So like that kind of idea is in there too, right? Like, so we have like all these stuff that would be used later, and I feel like this movie is pretty and probably heavily influenced to other films, although I've not seen too many before this. I have seen other Hong Kong and Chinese films, so usually the kung fu and fantasy stuff is from the Shaw Brothers, and it's less horror oriented, but this has that kind of horror stuff too. And like I said, obviously kind of a, you know, inspiration to maybe somebody like Sam Raimi, although 1977 we have Houseu, which could have been, you know, inspiration to Sam Raimi too, but it definitely have that playful kind of lead that's just kind of like comical but also trying to survive. Anyways, really dug this one. There is a commentary on here, where is it, sorry about that, by Asian film expert Frank Jin, and he starts to talk a little bit about, you know, some of the dialogue used and how that would be a reference to kind of a, you know, lots of different stuff like an old shoe, and like that's interesting too and helps with context. Anyways, Encounter of a Spooky Kind, another good one for 1980, and it's just a lot of movies I get to watch for the first time I'm excited about, so this is a cool one. Sammo Hung for the win. Good stuff. Okay, the next one from 1980 is one I've seen before, and this is The Beast. Now, some people explain this as kind of like a Hong Kong version of Deliverance or Last House on the Left. And yeah, I can see that. So essentially, this version is actually in English. I watched it online in Cantonese, the original language. I suggest you do that. I did watch some of the English one, and it's just a little bit too much here. So what we have here is, like, the movie opens up, and the opening reminded me of, like, Hunting Party in a lot of ways, where we have, like, that brutal animal killing. And so, warn you, real animal violence here. We have this group of kind of, like, these kind of backwoods guys, and they're all really memorable looking, especially this guy here with the teeth licking the hook. You might recognize that from the opening. So essentially, there's like five of them, and they like catch this pig, and it's real brutal, and they obviously kill it, and you kind of like are introduced to these people in that way. You're like, I know who these people are, and they seem to almost take pleasure in it. there's like a group of them, and it's called the Beast, and they do like have animals, and they kill animals, and some of them even have animal-like qualities about them. So these are kind of the villains of the story, and they're introduced, and it's like kind of the location as well, this isolated place and scary. So essentially what we have here is five people are going out camping. They kind of like say goodbye to their family, their father, the main characters. We have a sister and brother, kind of the leads here, and they go out, and after a while they run into a couple of these backwoods people, very typical kind of exploitation style stuff here, and it's kind of it's really weird and uncomfortable, of course, and then a couple of the guys come back and they leave. Unfortunately, the girl is out by herself, and she's like washing some clothes or dishes, and the gang of thugs or beasts come across her, and they molest her, they rape her, of course. It's fairly graphic. It's not as graphic as some of the stuff, but they do show some things. And there's some small little touches in there that are, you know, add to the sleaziness or uncomfortability of it. You know, somebody licking her ear, shit like that. They also, I should mention that the group of kind of rapists or villains have like a mentally handicapped person with them at the same time, like this kind of balder guy who doesn't really partake in any of the violence against them, but he's kind of guilty by association, and he's just kind of lost without any friends, and he doesn't really know what to do. And he's not treated very well. You kind of have some sympathy for this character, the big bald guy. So what happens is the brother goes out for revenge right away, and it gets worse for these people. And anyways, the two are very badly damaged or killed. I don't want to spoil absolutely everything. And the father of this comes back, and he wants his vengeance, of course. And that kind of turns into like him picking them off, and I don't want to say almost slasher ways, but the deaths are over the top and kind of extreme, and kind of aligned with like I Spit on Your Grave or something like that. And the addition of the mentally handicapped guy with the group of them obviously is a thing like I Spit on Your Grave, right, with Matthew. So the father picks them off, you know, one by one until the climax, and there's some nice touches in here, you know, the gang fighting with each other, very similar to I Spit on Your Grave. The one thing, you know, in like a revenge movie or a rape revenge movie like this, you kind of feel a little bit, I know this is weird and I don't know if this is justified or not, but you feel a little bit more comfortable. And I've had friends, somebody say this to me before, you know, I'd rather have the person who's assaulted get the revenge than someone else. It just feels a little bit more, I don't know, like cathartic in a way. You feel less guilty about the grittiness or whatever the hell. You guys understand what I'm saying. So the picking them off is pretty intense. The first one, it's off. There's a couple off-screen ones, but you see the aftermath, and I think that's worth the price of admission. You know, kind of like the aftermath's a little bit, kind of the reveal is pretty cool. One of the characters, the snake guy, is just one of the best villains ever. He looks straight up like Richard Ramirez. And he's just has a growling voice. He's really weird and creepy and just kind of a good villain, to be honest. He was kind of made for these kind of roles, I imagine. And he's just really memorable, as well as the bald guy. And I think the bald guy's in lots and lots of movies if you look him up. So, like, those two stand out to me. There is a lot of snake killings in this movie. Dozens of snakes are killed violently. You know, it's like Stanley or something. A lot of killing of snakes. I know that's going to be uncomfortable. I obviously didn't like watching it, but it's 1980. It seems like the last hurrah of animal violence in movies. Hell, Cannibal Holocaust is the same year. So Friday 13th, there's a lot of animal cruelty happening in 1980 from all countries, including China, Hong Kong, Italy, America. It's just, unfortunately, still a staple of cinema at the time, especially genre cinema. So the ending of this movie is, it's one of those kind of mean-spirited endings that I feel like is the proper way to go. For this kind of thing. I really like this movie. I know it's kind of just explaining how horrible it is and messed up it is. Everybody's like, I like that. Because I like these kind of films. I like the backwoods kind of stuff. And, you know, City Meets That. I wonder, it's not had a good release in the States or maybe ever. It was remade twice, which is fucking bonkers to me. Loose remakes, I believe, 1999. One with Anthony Wong called Deadly Camp. And again in 2003, The Beast, a.k.a. Deadly Camp again. I think that third version is the most rare to come across, to be honest. So it's just bizarre this movie was remade twice, especially that close. I don't know how close the movies are and everything like that. But anyways, the bad guys are real sleazy in this, real nasty. You enjoy watching them get killed. But yeah. I would have liked to see a little bit more on-screen kills. I like the father. He's kind of a Charles Bronson-esque character, right? Silent, strong type. And the ending, it works well. I imagine that this isn't released because there's a lot of bigger needle drops. I think that the police are in here. Message in a Bottle, I think, plays. Songs like that, you know, that it's just like, I don't know how the fuck they would clear those rights for something like The Beast, which is kind of just a sleazy kind of, you know, flick from 1980. But... one that might be, I guess, a hidden gem for some people, to be honest, because it has that weird quality of, like, I like these kind of revenge movies. I love revenge movies, and especially when they kind of cross over into the horror exploitation area, I just kind of, like, always seek them out. But, yeah, it's not going to be for everybody. And it's a scary location, like I said, being in the woods like that, and everything like that. Right when those people came across me, and they started acting like that, I'd be like, we got to go. We don't want to be anywhere near these people because something, you're just asking for trouble at that point. I guess we're going to do the pervert card for this 1980 flick, and this is Zoom In Sex Apartments, aka Zoom In Rape Apartments, and that's probably a more close title. This is from the Nakatsu Erotic Films Collection. This is part 5. This is the 5th release in that collection, and I'd heard a little bit about the Zoom Up and Zoom In movies. I've seen one of them. I can't remember the name. They're all so similar, and they have alternate names, which is really crazy, kind of Gialli-style story in apartment complex and murders and stuff. It was really good. This Zoom In Sex Apartments movie is freaking wild, and obviously... you're getting your pervert cards out for this one. The first 5 minutes, 10 minutes of this movie, there's like 2 rapes. I was just like, geez, Louise. And so essentially what's happening is there's a monster going around and raping women and like burning them, like and burns them in his brutal way, burns their genitals. And there's an aftermath shot in the beginning where I was like, I can't believe they showed that. But essentially our lead character, her boyfriend, her husband is leaving on a trip and she goes for a bike ride and she's raped on the way there. And pretty brutal fashion. She ends up going someplace and meeting an old lover, and they start to talk, and right away you suspect this old lover. Is he the rapist? Is he the arsonist killer? Are they the same? All this kind of element playing here. As it goes on, you start to kind of like see more rapes and more murders, and you start to suspect this guy more and more as it progresses. And she also has this weird kind of sexual fantasies and fetishes as well, and it just starts to blur these lines and make it really uncomfortable in that situation. To make matters more complex, we have this other girl who seems to be homeless and kind of I don't want to say like degenerate or something like that. She starts to like witnesses one of the burns, people being killed and murdered and burned alive, maybe, possibly. And she kind of just like becomes infatuated with the whole situation as well. So it becomes this weird kind of love triangle and just a lot of sleaze, a lot of sex, a lot of long pinky sex scenes, as you guys know, and rape scenes. Those are in here as well. But by the end of the movie, it was just completely bonkers and it gets really surreal and kind of in this weird fantasy sex scene, which I thought was kind of like different in these. Like if you ever felt like you wanted to see people be burned alive, then this is the movie for you. It would make kind of a nice, I guess, another centerpiece or brother sister piece with something like Don't Go in the House, which aka The Burning, which is essentially just, you know, a guy burning women with a flamethrower. That one's a little bit more psychological, based in Psycho, and this one is more like a sexual, you know, weird fantasy thing too, like with her sexuality. Obviously not going to be for everybody. Really weird shit. And the murders, like the one murder, I was just taken back. And like, there's a moment where like the father of the victim is kind of like messed up at the very end because of all of it. Anyways, just a really twisted, weird movie from 1980, a pinky movie. So I think we're already hitting, like, we got an American movie, some Chinese, Hong Kong movies, and then we have a Japanese film. So kind of a widespread on what we've been talking about so far for 1980. But this is from the Nakatsu Erotic Films Collection from Impulse. If you're interested, this is one of the more brutal ones, I would say, from that line so far. Okay, the next one up is from 1980, again, of course, and I think this movie is kind of uncompleted or had a lot of trouble in production. This is by kind of the legendary director Roger Walkins, who directed the movie Last House on Dead End Street from 1973. He also directed some porno films, including Corruption, Put About Vinegar Syndrome, and this is a bootleg of Shadows of the Mind. I don't know if it's ever had a proper release. I'm sure some people have a VHS floating around. This kind of reminded me of the movie from 1970, Jenny, which I think is that a Roberta Finley or Doris first Wishman. I don't remember which, but I think it's Roberta Finley. So essentially that movie is like this weird kind of psychological thing where this woman goes around and murders. But it also was kind of a mixture of Jose Larraz's Symptoms. Of course, not nearly as good as Symptoms, but it is better than Janie, I would say. So what we have here is this girl who has witnessed a horrible act with her parents. They both drowned. I think her father and like a stepmother, they both drowned and died. Maybe it's her actual parents, and she's been haunted by it. She's been in a hospital ever since. The doctor decides to let her go out, thinks she's ready to see the real world. She's kind of released back to like her family estate. She owns it. They have a lot of money. They had a lot of money, so she kind of goes to this estate. There's a caretaker there that's a very bizarre. Going to this estate is obviously not going to do her any good. Her stepbrother shows up, and he's a slimy piece of shit. We get narration from a lot of people, including the brother and including her, and we have a lot of these flashbacks that go back and forth. So we kind of have this like psychological kind of thing going on for like about 40 minutes. The movie's about an hour and 20, and then the first murder occurs, and you don't really know if somebody's behind the thing pulling the strings, and you're not 100% sure who's committing the murders, but you really kind of have a general idea. As it goes on, the murders are fairly graphic, especially the first one that involves a scythe, which I think is actually on the VHS cover if anybody's ever seen it. And then later we have another kind of murder involving somebody getting stabbed in the eye. So the murders that actually happen are pretty grotesque, and I like these kind of movies where we have like a psychologically damaged character finally snapping or kind of diving into it. It doesn't seem like there's absolutely enough to make a complete movie, but what we have here is fairly decent enough to see kind of like and watch and check out and see like, yeah, this is all right. You know, it could have been a lot better, but it could have been a hell of a lot worse. And when the killings actually happen, I think they're quite effective. And there is a reveal, which I do kind of like these reveals where you actually see exactly what caused the trauma and everything like that. But that's Shadows of the Mind. Had to watch the Roger Watkins movie because Last House Said Dead Edge Street's kind of a, you know, fairly prolific movie in the extreme genre, and I know that he did a lot of other films as well, but that is Shadows of the Mind. Okay movie. I'm glad I watched it for 1980, kind of mix it up, and something that I had never seen before. Okay, the next one up from 1980 is another bootleg, and this is Terror on Tour. This is like a rock and roll horror film or heavy metal. Remember those heavy metal kind of horror films that came out? A lot of them like Rocktober Blood or Shock of Dead. This one's more like rock and roll style. This is directed by Don Emmons, who was an actor turned director. He did a couple of the Ilsa movies, the first two, I believe, the legendary awesome Ilsa and the She-Wolf of the SS, and then Ilsa and the Oil Shriek, Harmon of the Oil Shriek. So Don Emmons obviously has some good exploitation films under his belt. Elsa's a classic, right? So I was like, okay, finally time to watch Terror on Tour. I actually watched it online again. You know, you can watch it on YouTube, stuff like that. And I was like, man, boy, I'm not, this is pretty unwatchable in terms of quality. It's one of these dark VHSs that when you watch it, you can't see a damn thing. So essentially what we have here is a band, the manager, all the kind of major characters in the movie. They all look similar. It doesn't help that a lot of them dress up in makeup. So you're by there, you're like, I don't know who any of these characters are because the dialogue's very poor. They don't really stand out. And, you know, they're all dressed in makeup. Every time they go on tour, there's a prostitute that's murdered. There's some sex scenes, some nudity and stuff, of course. But there's a prostitute that's killed. A police detective gets involved. He even tries to get somebody that he knows that's kind of a snitch or whatever to go undercover and be involved with this as well. So yeah, basically that's kind of the movie. Every time they have a concert, somebody gets picked off. There's a lot of dialogue. It's not very well edited because like there's a lot of the moments where like there'll be tons of dead air in between lines. They'll be like, yeah, that's a great song. Then it cuts to somebody else. Yeah, I think I'm good at guitar. It's just like, why is this edited so poorly? Like, I don't know if they're trying to pad the runtime, but this needs to, like, the dialogue seems very unrealistic. It's edited very poorly. There's so much air in between all the lines. It's just very deadpan and very poorly acted, to be honest. And like I said, I don't know who any of the characters are because I can't fucking see them. You know what I mean? Like, and they're barely memorable in the first place. But of course, there is a killer. And it's kind of strange, too. Like, you know, usually slasher movies, you have a group of friends and they go out and they get picked off by a killer from the outside, or there's a killer on the inside picking them off. It's not usually, you know, a group of friends and there's a killer from the inside picking off other people that are completely unrelated to any of these fucking people for the most part, right? It's kind of strange. It's just weird. And, you know, it's 1980. It's early in the slasher kind of boom. So, like, I guess the rules weren't set. It's an unknown shadow force or a group within killing the people that are there. I mean, a couple of the people that are involved with the group do get picked off. Not particularly a good movie, honestly. It was kind of boring, kind of hard to follow because all the characters look similar. They're all in makeup and it just looked poorly done, like in some aspects in terms of editing. But maybe if it was cleaned up, it would help a bit, you know, right? I could tell the characters apart. I could hear the dialogue better and everything like that. And this, I saw a few additions floating around online, and I watched the best looking one, and it still wasn't great, let's be honest. So Terron Tor, just, I don't think it's a particularly very good movie. It's not well loved or anything like that. I don't know any of the actors in there. There is some sleaze and nudity and stuff like that if you're interested in that. The detective is such a... The one detective is always telling this other detective what to do, and it's just like, why don't you fucking do something? You're just standing here drinking a fucking cup of coffee, telling everybody what to do. You're doing absolutely fucking nothing about the case. So, like, it's just not a very good movie. I'm sorry. Like, I like, and that might change if it was a better edition, but I really don't think so, because I said the editing is terrible, the dialogue is terrible, the acting is terrible, the characters are terrible, and there's no, like, pace... Like, it's just poorly done into the terms where you can't really follow, because everybody's talking about boring shit, nobody stands out. They do try to create some intrigue with, you know, a character having like a note that was written to him, and you can see their psychological kind of crumblings, but you, and it's kind of left vague who it is, but I really had trouble giving a shit. And it's just strange, and it's just like, now we introduce a prostitute or a groupie and they are killed, and it's just like, like, you're just introducing new characters to kill every time, and I get it, that's the character's, the killer's MO, but at the same time, the slasher world wasn't yet created, and this is just a formula I'm glad we didn't really go with. It could be good, but Terron Tor is not good, so, sorry. Not the worst movie, of course, or anything like that, but, you know, it's like a 2 out of 5 or some shit like that, so that's what I go with, somewhere around there, Terron Tor. Okay, and the last one from 1980 is just a crazy one, and this is Choi Hawk. It's not spelled that way, but it's pronounced Choi Hawk, and this is Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind, I believe it's called that. Yeah, Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind. Now, there's a couple cuts of this film. I watched the director's cut. There is a theatrical cut, and the runtimes, I think, are about 5 minutes different. Some people list the runtimes as, you know, 95 to 100 minutes. There's sometimes 90 to 95 minutes, regardless. The director's cut incorporates VHS footage because that footage was lost. So some people explain this as kind of like the craziest nihilistic punk rock movie, and this is more of like a thriller, I guess, but it's psychologically really messed up and really twisted and really exploitative in a lot of ways, but very, very smart too. Again, some real brutal animal cruelty in this movie involving mice and a cat, which I was kind of taken back at a little bit. I'm not going to lie. I was kind of like, oh shit, I can't believe that's there. I can't believe they did that. And it is bothersome. So kind of like we see that animal cruelty by a point of view. You don't know which character is doing it, but when we eventually find out which character is, it just kind of says millions of things about this character, to be honest. So essentially the director's cut involves a lot of kind of like homemade bombs by these teens, these kind of, I guess it would be like modern day incels. That's why this movie is really resonates now, because you have a lot of these mass shooters and these kids are damaged, and like, yeah, it really feels like it works today too. You're right. So we have these three young men that are planning these, like, they plan a movie theater bomb, which is fucked, right? And it goes off. It's like this little dirty bomb. They don't know if they killed anybody or anything like that. So they scurry off, but this young woman witnessed them do it, and she starts to follow them around. She's a little bit older. She starts to use them and manipulate them, and they all end up getting involved with, you know, some more bombs, but also they find this kind of, this foreigner, I believe British guy. This is a Hong Kong movie, of course, this British guy. And he's carrying this suitcase, and they steal his notes, which are these notes that are basically for like a million yen Japanese money. And they take them, and they try to get them like cashed in and all everything, and they have all these different kind of things like that. I should mention that the woman, is her brother is a cop, you know, and she's younger, and he's trying to take care of her, all this kind of shit. So he starts to get involved with the business and everything. But soon enough, all kind of like roads lead to these group of young people that are involved with the bombings and the stolen money. So they got criminals and cops and all this kind of shit after them. And like, there's these really kind of brutal moments in the very beginning of the movie. Slight spoiler here. It's kind of a spoiler, but we have this cat that's thrown on this barbed wire fence. And throughout the entire movie, you see it rot and rot and rot, the situation getting worse and worse and worse. And one of those characters ends up on that fence too. And it's just kind of like poetic justice for that character, or kind of like saying a lot of things like that. The end of the movie takes place in a graveyard, and it's just like an amazing kind of shootout and stuff. And just like weird action stuff going on. And the last shot is kind of just like, yeah, That's about right. That's probably that kind of mentality at this point. But it's just a weird, crazy movie. And it's just these emotions and these feelings of young people and like the mental illness and fucked up, you know, ideas that they have in here and stuff. Just feels like it resonates. And it's just like kind of like the ideology or mental kind of shit of people never really changes, right? Like these ideas are always there, this kind of violence, this kind of bored recklessness and whatever. It just all feels there and disconnect from humanity. And just, I don't know, it's just a wild movie. And I love the lead female in here. She's got a tremendous look. She's got a really great performance, and she's just really iconic. And I don't think I'll ever forget her in this movie, to be honest. Like I said, that animal cruelty is real rough in this one. Like, I was like, fuck, I can't believe they did that. Between this and The Beast already, I'm just like, man, there's gonna be a lot of dead animals in 1980. And I'm not, obviously we're gonna get to those cannibal movies too, which I've seen. But yeah, it's just, it just kind of took me back on this one. Really well made, really good action moments too, and suspense, and just the city looks so, so perfect how it's filmed and how it takes place. And just like I said, it's got a grittiness and dangerousness, a lot of danger to it. I will say that, they do use Dawn of the Dead music. They use Goblin music, and it's one of two movies from 1980 that I can think of that rips the Dawn of the Dead score. I'm looking at you, Bruno Mattei, you fuck. I love you. But yeah, so one of two movies that rips the Dawn of the Dead score, and I don't know if the theatrical version has it as well. But the score's really good. Obviously, some of it's Dawn of the Dead. I feel like maybe they lifted the rest of the score, but it's all good. And good set pieces, good action. Just a strange, bizarre movie. Like I said, not necessarily horror at all, but it fits that dark kind of thriller crime, and I think it crosses over, and I don't think anybody else would have this movie, if that makes any sense to anybody. But that is Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind, is which what I they believe at the time they called bombings, and this is inspired by real bombings and stuff like that. That's why it was cut out of the theatrical cut, because of that. But anyways, Choi Hawk is kind of a famous director, and he's done a lot of movies, and I think I covered one on here before. And you know, he's done some other things too that I would definitely love to dive into. It's kind of funny that I did Spooky Encounters of the First Kind, Encounter of the Spooky Kind, and Dangerous Encounters of the First Kind on the same video. But I've been wanting the meaning to watch this movie forever. But yeah, gritty, crazy, dark, just messed up stuff here. But yeah, not exactly the most feel-good movie in 1980. Not at all. Hey guys, what's up? We're here for Blind Spot. This is your pick here.
Oh yeah.
This is Comedy of Terrors, AIP Picture. It's directed by Jacques Tourneur, I believe is how you say his name. Jacques Tourneur, French director. He did Cat People, which we covered on here before. Classic movie.
The black and white one.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
And there's people and they turn into cats.
Yeah, he also did Night of the Demon, which is another kind of classic that we should probably watch down the line.
It's
not Night of the Demons. It's also not Night of the Demon, the 1980 fucking Bigfoot exploitation video nasty. It's a completely different movie. And he did, I think, some more stuff for Val Lewton produced stuff, which kind of... So anyways, we're here to do Comedy of Terrors.
Yes.
Starring the late great talents of four actors, all passed away. Vincent Price, Peter Lorre, Boris Karloff, and Basil Rathbone. And I... probably a bit dick for leaving out the other actors in the movie, but when you have people like that, they kind of overshadow every single
person.
There's
only like a handful of other ones. Yeah. Like there's like two girls and a guy, each with one scene. Although the wife does have it.
Yeah, the wife's pretty great in it. So essentially, this is a really ridiculous movie. How many times had Vincent Price and Peter Lorre been in films together? We have The Raven. I know there's one of those film noirs that I think they share screen time.
Really?
I think so. I think we did watch that one. Maybe they were not in the same one.
They're in that, the Poe one.
Oh, yeah. I don't remember if that's Twice Told Tales or Tales of Terror, one of the two anthologies. Yeah, that one's great with the wine testing.
Yeah, with the wine testing.
That's amazing.
The price of pussy.
Under his breath. Yeah. So essentially, this is the story of Vincent Price and Peter Lorre, who run this kind of a mortuary business. They're real shiesty. They're kind of Burke and Hare style characters.
Kind of.
Just more silly.
Yeah.
And they do everything illegal to try to make money until, of course, it turns into murder. Vincent Price is very casual about committing the murders. Boris Karloff is Vincent Price's father-in-law. He's going deaf. He's absolutely unhinged and ridiculous in it. Mm-hmm. And Basil Rathbone is Vincent Price's landlord. Vincent Price spends the majority of the movie bad-mouthing his wife and arguing with his wife in the most hilarious ways. He's an absolute villain and a terrible person. So, yeah,
that's pretty much what's going on in the plot of this movie. There's a lot of slapstick stuff, a lot of really clever back and forth between all the actors and stuff like that, and puns and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's a really, like, I would say it's more comedy than horror. Vincent Price and Peter Lorre, I think, have like a Abbott and Costello kind of feel going on. Lorre is like a former criminal or criminal in hiding, if you will. So
Price is taking advantage of
it. Price just uses that to like extort him to like help him commit murders, B&Es. And basically they have to pay their landlord, Basil
Rathbone.
I was going to say Rathburn.
I mean, he's all these guys, all of them have been in Universal War films, what I mean? So,
you know, he has to pay his landlord like a year's rent, and he doesn't. So, you know, let's get some more product to put in the ground. And they do that by basically trying to off, you know, some wealthy.
Instead of digging up bodies like Burke and Hare to sell them to medical doctors, they are actually just killing people so they have service for their funeral parlor.
Right.
There's so many great moments in here.
Oh, like, absolutely.
By far, the best scenes are when Price is absolutely appalled at the terrible human behavior that he encounters, even though he is the most repulsive person in the entire movie, a complete sociopath.
Right.
So essentially they kill somebody and they're rich and they expect that this person will pay for the funeral. And when the person skips town, Price has this little speech or whatever.
Like where's the morality,
what
man?
What happened to the morality, man? It's fucking the funniest thing ever. So good that they put it in the credits as well. We should mention Richard Matheson. Wrote some of the screenplay here. Matheson is probably one of the greatest horror writers of all time.
He did the I Am Legend guy, right?
Novella, and he worked on a lot of screenplays and stuff like that. Totally underrated. One of the most underrated horror writers of all time, probably.
I like him. He's all right.
I mean, it's also the work he worked in films and stuff like that. A lot of people can't do that.
No. Basically, what ultimately happens, the movie does take, I think, a little bit to like get going, because I think like the meat of the movie is what they do with the landlord, Basil, is, so, like, he goes through, like, episodes of, like, catatonic shock, where people think he's dead, doctors declare him dead, but he's really just kind of, like, sleeping, and then he wakes up, and, like, he always has this line, like, what place is this, and, so that happens, you know, several times, you know, throughout the movie, and eventually hijinks ensue, and
the end is pretty chaotic, to be honest. And there's really fun moments of you could tell that like Basil was like, I'll do it, but I want to do Shakespeare. So there's this long Shakespeare monologue where he thinks he's alone, and it just adds him to doing Shakespeare. It's just really funny. Like, if you like slapstick or goofy kind of humor with like Peter Lorre and Vincent Price, you can't really do better than having those two guys do this kind of stuff. I will say, though, Price looks at his best. I think he looks like probably at his most healthy I've ever seen him at one point. And Lorre looks the opposite. He does not look very healthy.
Well, I think Lorre...
He's older.
Lorre, Karloff, and maybe even Rathbone probably pass away for the next 5 years after making this. I'm fairly certain.
Well, what was Targets was 68 with Boris Karloff. That was one of his latter films for sure.
And this is 63?
He was in Cauldron of Blood, which was 1970 for Karloff. Karloff 70, 71, or late 60s, early 70s when he died.
Yeah.
So it's not too far off. This is 62, 63. So, yeah, within a decade, they were all dead.
Yeah. It's like for Price, who made it to the 90s. Early 90s. I would say that Karloff is probably the most underused character in this.
But his screen time is great.
Right.
Some of the humor reminded me of Arsenic and Old Lace.
It's very similar to Arsenic and Old Lace. And Lorre and Price have like an amazing chemistry together.
They always do.
You know, they're just really fun to see. Like, I think I actually like watching them more than I do Lee and Cushing interact. Although Horror Express is fantastic.
I don't know about that. It's such a different chemistry.
It is a different chemistry. Because, like I said, they have like a comedic thing going on, like very similar to like what it was in The Raven,
because as Lee is always straight man, even if he is comedic in it, he plays it by being funny, is by being like the straight guy, and while Price and Lorre can he do either or,
right?
But I would say that Price is more the straight man here, but just because he does things with a straight face, but he's saying the most ridiculous silly things at the same time.
I mean the movie is absurd in nature, but Price is a villain. You know he's a villain, but you know, I don't know if I'm rooting for him or, you know.
And it has the stuff that I find really funny is the reoccurring gags.
Yeah.
One with Poison and Karloff, which is so funny. Karloff's actually really great in it.
Oh, yeah.
The only downfall of this movie is he's not underutilized. I mean, because it's mostly the Peter Lorre, Vincent Price show. But
right.
I would have liked to see a little bit more of Karloff.
I would have liked to see him a bit more, you know, but... Like he does have good scenes. It's just he only has like two or three scenes and, you know, barely a minute or so. And then he just kind of has like the same dialogue over and over. Although his last scene is probably like the, you know, his finest part in the film.
I feel like the music in this was very like comical and silly, right? In a way.
Yeah, music was pretty okay.
So we got Creature Features by John Stanley. Comedy of Terrors. 1963, 4 out of 5 stars. Okay. Side-splitting parody, Undertaker's Vincent Price and Peter Lorre plot to finish off landlord Basil Rathbone, but bumble their own demises. Boris Karloff is hysterical role as an old geezer, with Joey Brown and Buxom Joyce Jameson adding to the macabre merriment. Directed a Jacques Turner, Curse of the Demon, thank you, Night of the Demon, makes sport of horror cliches with a cast that made the cliches famous. Classic black comedy script by Richard Matheson, first written as The Graveside Story. Okay. And I should mention that we mentioned Joey Brown because his scene in the cemetery is absolutely ridiculous. Remember that guy?
Is that the Irish guy?
Yeah.
That was the guy that's like, yeah, he's got one scene. Yeah.
Tear on Tape by James O'Neill.
Cats are chasing each other. Comedy of Terrors, 3 out of 4 stars, 1964. Price and Lorre are bumbling 19th century undertakers who decide to improve business by murdering landlord Rathbone and then staging an elaborate funeral. The trouble is, Basil doesn't die that easily. Though clearly slapped together in a hurry to take advantage of the success of The Raven, this farce has a funny script by Richard Matheson and gets a lot of mileage out of its once-in-a-lifetime cast with Lorre in especially winning form, a.k.a. The Graveside Story.
Yeah, so I would give it 4 out of 5. No complaints.
Yeah, I'd say 4 out of 5. It's a good, like, weekday watch, I feel. It's not too long.
Comfort food, put it on Halloween. Have a nice double feature with Arsenic and Old Lace, even though that's close to a 2-hour movie, so you might want to do a double feature with that.
Yeah, actually, I think Arsenic and Old Lace might be a more Halloween-y movie, because it does take place on Halloween.
But I'm just saying double feature.
But this is a good double feature with it. They're very... hand in hand. You know, unfortunately, you don't have Karloff in Arsenic and Old Lace, although they
it
wanted
should
to.
Have been, which is a nice Peter Lorre connection. So, anyways, we're both about the same, 4 out of 5.
Yeah, I'd say I just love Peter Lorre. I think he's fascinating. I think I've liked every movie he was in.
Yeah, I've never disliked anything.
Except for maybe Mad Love was kind of rough.
I like Mad Love. Mad Love's a great movie and way ahead. I mean, other movies kind of did stuff with Mad Love after and before, because the story hands at Orlok, right? But I'm just saying that there's some really iconic imagery in Mad Love that makes up for any of the shortcomings it would have.
Oh, yeah. Maltese Falcon was amazing. Yeah. He's too short in Casablanca.
I mean, he's great in everything. Let's
he is great in everything. I think Raven was a... fantastic. I just think he's really fun in it, and you know, Emmy's a really powerful performance.
Everybody knows Peter Lorre, Jeremy.
I'm talking about a guy I like. It's fun.
The one guy you know to remember is Peter Lorre.
The one guy, and Danny DeVito, and really we're not that far off.
Danny DeVito as Peter Lorre in Vincent Price biopic. Next week it's my pick.
Yep.
And where now the retro year is 1980.
Yeah, now we gotta do a 1980s.
So 1980 is one of the best years in horror ever. So how do I pick a movie? I pick one of the lesser known movies of 1980. It's not one of the best movies in 1980. So this one we're gonna do is Silent Scream, because we're on a short running time. It's an hour. It's part of the Hammer House of Horrors, which we didn't watch for the Hammer time.
No.
There's 13 episodes. We're not gonna watch all of them. I'm not gonna make you watch all of them. I'm gonna watch all of them. But this one is the one that I remembered most from the Elvira tapes, when she used to do the introductions for them in the video stores, the Thriller tapes. And it's called Silent Scream with Brian Cox and Peter Cushing. And I always remember really liking this one, so that's what we're going to do next week.
That's what we're going to do next week. Next week.
Don't you even think about skipping on that soy gravy.
Before we get into the questions and stuff, let's do my top 10. I'm going to give you my top 30 of 1994 and 5 movies that I watched that I really like that I don't consider horror enough to include on the list. Some of my freaking list, anyways, isn't exactly horror. You know how it goes. So if you want to get in-depth and listen to this, go over to the 22 Shots and Boots and Horror. You can listen to all our lists, our top tens. We go in a little bit more depth, of course. So let's start this out with five movies I watched that I really enjoyed that I did not consider horror enough to include on the list. 1941, Hong Kong on Fire. Yeah, this is a really crazy exploitation kind of war drama, which obviously kind of shares similarities to Black Sun, the Nanking Massacre. Then we also have a Chinese torture chamber, really kind of weird comedy sex movie, which I really enjoyed. Angel Guts, Red Flash. Man, this is a crazy thriller. I love the stylistic look of it. It was really good. I definitely would rewatch this one for sure. Surviving the Game, you know, Most Dangerous Game style story. They hunt Ice-T. Great cast. Rutger Hauer, Charles S. Dutton, John C. McKinley, Gary Busey, F. Murray Abraham, William McNamara, and fucking Ice-T. You can't beat it. And a Jeff Corey. Great movie. I reviewed all these movies, too, if you want anything more in-depth on the channel. Just search. And, of course, the best non-horror movie I include is Heavenly Creatures by Peter Jackson. It's a freaking masterpiece based on a true story. Amazing performances, fantasy, weird elements. So now let's get into the top 30. And anything from 30 to 20 is whatever order, right? So number 30, Underground Banker, less horror, kind of more exploitation, listed as horror on Internet Movie Database. Anthony Wong goes against this weird kind of banker, real brutal murder in here of his kid getting set on fire. Not murder, but set on fire. Underground Banker, really crazy, weird exploitation movie. 29, Hello, Who Is It? Weird Hong Kong movie about a girl who's raped and killed, and she goes into the phone lines to kill her rapist. This also has, like, one of the guys who's in, like, every Hong Kong movie as a rapist. He's, like, real crazy and skinny, and he's got, like, wide gaps between his teeth. Really good performance by him. Like the idea of people getting killed by phone lines. Pretty wild kills. Two versions of this movie, one that's cut with subtitles and one that's uncut without subtitles. So I watched the original version, and I was like, oh, that's good. And then I watched the uncut version just to see the scenes, like in murders and deaths and stuff. And some of the stuff I was like, oh, wow, that rape scene was really nasty in the uncut version. Just small little details that they add in, like tears coming from her eye after she's dead. And you're just like, oh, that's fucking gross. 28, The Rapist, which is based on a true story. Really kind of crazy police procedural movie, similar to Ready to Kill, rapist movie. 20, Hong Kong movie, of course. 27, Wrath of Silence, about basically this like serial rapist going around, and he's real gross and he uses like bugs on people, and like a mortician's got to stop him. It's pretty crazy, weird movie. 26, Shrunken Heads from Full Moon. Really enjoy this one. Danny Elfman, Richard Elfman movie. Just fun. I don't know who it's made for, but I've always enjoyed it. 25, Funny Man. First time I watched this, didn't love it. Rewatched it. Really entertaining, zany slasher movie from the UK with Christopher Lee, of course. 24, Phantasm 3, Lord of the Dead. Love the road horror stuff. Reggie Bannister is the man. Love that he fights a bunch of zombies. And one is John Chandler Davies. Great stuff there. And then we have 23. This is no order. The bottom 10 are in any order, right? Mix them up however you want. Puppet Masters, Donald Sutherland, sci-fi story. Really crazy stuff. Obviously a body snatcher story. 22, Angel Dust. Really well-made Japanese horror thriller. Really kind of strange. And I feel like if I watched it a couple more times, I would have it higher on the list. 21, Wes Craven's New Nightmare. A lot of cool ideas in this movie. Really great stuff. Love seeing Wes act in the movie. And just different, Nightmare on Elm Street movie that's really solid and different. But it does have some shakiness. Like, you're basically redoing it and have your last moment on Nightmare on Elm Street, Wes Craven, but you make the kills less, whatever. Maybe it's the time. And then we have 20, Night Watch. That's kind of in a vein of a thriller at the same time, but I think it crosses over with some of the kills. Like I said, it's been a long time since I watched a lot of these. Just a well-made kind of thriller horror film. 19, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein went up for me on the third watch. Great performances, but it seems like it's missing about 20 minutes of Frankenstein footage, my Frankenstein monster footage, but it's a really well-made professional movie, and I do like a lot of the things that they do in it. 18, Wolf with Jack Nicholson. Love Jack Nicholson, Mike Nichols movie. A lot of good actors in this, a lot of good dialogue. Jack Nicholson is a fucking werewolf. How could he go wrong? 17, Sammy and the T-Rex. Super bonkers, weird, funny, zany movie with a great cast. Fucking animatronic T-Rex, Buckflower. That's all you need to know. 16, Wicked Games. Tim Ritter shot on video, sequel to Truth or Dare. It's really weird. Check out the Snuff Edition if you want something even weirder. Love Joel D for life. 15, Bloodlust Subspecies 3. Gotta love Subspecies 3. 2 and 3 are just a blast. The crazy mob monster zombie thing. Love that. Anyways, it's just a lot of fun. Really enjoyed it. Monsters and Castle Windows is basically how I explain this. 14, miniseries The Kingdom by Lars von Trier. Helmer for life. That's all I'm going to say. Really, really well made kind of miniseries that sucks you in. 13, The Stand by Stephen King. One that I had a lot of nostalgia for. Always had a closeness to it because I saw it as a kid. Great cast. The last act kind of falls apart, but that's due to the book. They did a really good job with what they had, let's be honest. 12, Mosquito. Really fun kind of Michigan horror film by Josh Becker. Just really cool special effects. Giant mosquitoes killing people. 11, can't believe this didn't make my top 10, but it didn't. Savage Harvest by Eric Stanzi. Low budget SOV, Evil Dead kind of style thing. Really really well made for a SOV movie. Good camera shots. Good mythology created by him for this kind of stuff. Native American kind of demons ripping people apart. Great stuff. 10. Red to Kill by Billy Tang. Crazy Cat 3 movie if you have not seen it. Basically a mentally handicapped person's raped by this kind of crazy killer that has a trigger every time they see red they have to kill and rape. Really crazy movie. Really mean-spirited. 9. Love Minus Zero Equal Infinity by Hisayasu Sato. Really weird voyeuristic Sato movie. Kind of typical but different vampire tale, possibly question mark. Science gone mad tale. Corporation, capitalism, greed. Good movie. 8, Feel-A-Dead, the animated movie, really good. Cat Giallo, yeah, like it's a genre or something, but anyways, it's really good, really well animated, and really dark stuff, really good stuff, loved it. 7, Brain Scan by John Flynn, love this movie, childhood favorite again. Edward Furlong gets sucked into a weird video game, you can't tell reality and fantasy, carries out murders, the guitar riff is fucking awesome in this movie. Number 6, which I should switch, this should be number 5, I'm going to do it right now. Number 6 is Interview with the Vampire, big scale. Scaling epic Hollywood movie, well directed, well acted, more gory than one would expect. Number 5, Shattered Dead, SOV classic, amazing story by Scooter McRae. Just a bonkers, really dark and grim, depressing movie that I've always loved. Number 4, it's a tie, and I shouldn't do that. I normally wouldn't do that, but I included these together. My Sweet Satan and Roadkill, The Last Days of John Martin. It's two shorts released on the same tape by Film Threat by Jim Van Beber. Just great shorts. If nobody's ever seen them, they're on YouTube. Check them out. One's based on a true story, kind of. Updated version, and one's kind of like this old weird Texas Chainsaw thing. Great stuff, great gore, just hit hard punk rock shit, you know. 3, Serial Mom by John Waters. I consider it a horror film, a horror comedy for sure, comedy horror. The killings in this are brilliant. Katherine Turner's brilliant, very funny, the funniest movie of the year, had me in tears, love it. 2, In the Mouth of Madness, kind of an underrated John Carpenter movie about mass hysteria. It's just really unique. Lovecraft love letter, Stephen King love letter, great cast, Sam Neill, Jorgen Prichow, Julie Carmen, everybody. And number 1, of course, is Cemetery Man by Michele Soave. Just a endlessly entertaining dark comedy. It's fit for Shakespeare, all right, let's say it. Zombies, Nagi, sex, just great stuff, Cemetery Man. So that is my top 30 of 1994. I watched 120 movies, 112 features, 6 shorts, and 2 miniseries for 1994. I left some off the table. I didn't rewatch The Crow. Never really considered a horror film. Didn't rewatch Ghoulies 4 and stuff like that, and I just really couldn't take it. But yeah, so let's get into these questions, comments, concerns, all that good thing. Check my... I'm talking really fast here because I don't want my audio to go out. Okay, so last week I asked you most unhinged performances in a movie, but some people are answering other things. Okay, my 2, fun watch. I love angst and comedy. Terrors is great. Very fun movie. Those two are so different and show you can make so many varieties of great horror. I'll toss Klaus Kinski in there for over-the-top performances since I originally had Cage and it was a little obvious. Oh, Matthew McConaughey and Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Next Generation. Just, wow. Another 1994. Not My Truth. The Truth. The plot to Wild Things becomes a little bit creepier when you realize it's not a college, but a high school. No shit. Ken Coakley, I love The Harder They Come. There was a movie theater in Cambridge, Massachusetts called the Orson Welles Theater. The movie played at the theater for 6 years. One time when I was about 9, I convinced my brother to take me to see the movie. He gave in. There's a scene that has the Ivanhoe character being photographed by a professional photographer. When that scene came up, a really good-looking guy who was mimicking the scene. It turned out to be the star of the film, Jimmy Cliff. He signed a napkin for me and he told me to never give up on my dreams. I wish I had listened to him, LOL. Andrew, that's a great story. Andrea Brigitte, I love your reviews. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Ken Coakley, most off-the-rails performance I saw was Rutger Hauer in the U.S. debut of Nighthawks. He played an international terrorist being chased by a New York cop played by Sylvester Stallone. Then a year later, he did another manic performance in Blade Runner. Hell, and is also his off-the-rails performance in freaking The Hitcher. Honorary mentions go to Joe Spinella Maniac, as well as Richard Liberty, as well as Joe Pilato in Day of the Dead. Must listen to me, Captain. You must listen to me. Listen to this. Kentuckinator. I knew I remembered a bear costume slasher flick. That's right. That's Girls' Night Out. D. Gulag. Agreed. Girls' Night Out is a total charmer. I found myself going back to it over the years just because it's fun. John Soloway. David Argo is Dicko, the maniac Rue Hunter and Razorback. He and his brother Benny are more scary than the actual Razorback in that movie. The actor David just went completely off the script, his fellow actors constantly struggling to keep up. He even bought his own costume to wear. Deidre Keith, Dieter Laser in Human Centipede 3 could be the single most over-the-top performance in screen history. There were times when you generally could serve for the man's health. Yeah. Ryan Vincent Logston, Sizemore and MBK. I've never wounded anything in my life. Of course, Mark Ball, Everyone in Possession, agreed. Rich Rabbit, John Lithgow in the Twilight Zone movie. I love Credence, love that. Tom Brooker, Isabella Johnny in Possession, agreed. William Adcock, Ernest Borgnine in Emperor of the North. He's legit terrifying. Love that movie. Johnny Brecko, I don't want to say your name, Brezex. Harvey Keitel in Bad Lieutenant. Good one. Beep, beep. Zachary Puccinelli, Nick Cage in The Wicker Man. The Bees, Lacey Liu, Emma Roberts, Scream 4. Troy Howarth, Neville Brand, and William Finley are equal, about equal in Eaten Alive. No, everybody in Eaten Alive is just screaming at the top of their lungs. Why? Who knows? It's a Tobe Hooper movie. And then he also says, and for sheer drunken lunacy, Jack Palance and Justine is just hard to beat. Joachim Johansson, Dennis Hopper in Texas Chainsaw 2. Vincent Panera, also Bill Moseley in the same movie, right? He says Bill Moseley in the same. Charles Meacham, Mikael Shannon, Bug. Great choice. Scary performance, too. Nick Cage, Bad Lieutenant. 2. Brad Pitt, 12 Monkeys, D. Wallace, Frighteners, and he says basically Charles Meacham says Michael Shannon, Bug, Nick Cage, Bad Lieutenant 2, Brad Pitt, 12 Monkeys, D. Wallace, Frighteners, Tim Walker, Susan Tyrell, and Butcher Baker, Nightmare Maker comes to mind. Agreed. Maybe Arch Hall Jr. in The Sadist as well. Gian Cosbro, me as Harry Russo, yeah, for sure, from the Schizophreniac and Necromaniac movies. Justin Burning, my answer is Isabella Johnny in Possession, but honorable mention for my man Peter Hooten in Night Killer. No idea what the fuck he's doing in that movie. I got molested in the little boy's room. Good call on that one. Michael Fisher, Wendy Roby and The People Under the Stairs, good call. Terrence Cover, maybe not the most, but the most recent one that stood out to me as being full on bonkers choice was Christopher Walken in Communion. How dare you? Kyle Raburn, Cage in Willy's Wonderland, Marcus Cook, Dennis Hopper as Frank Booth. Oh, yeah. John Devlin, Christopher Walken in Communion, Nicolas Cage in Wicker Man, and Tommy Wiseau in The Room. Cassidy Botwin, Susan Tyrell in Butcher Baker Nightmare Maker. I agree. Aaron Mozella, Isabella Johnny in Possession, Chris Leppard, Wings Hauser in Champagne and Bullets. Josh Hayes, I'm going to say Harvey Keitel in Bad Lieutenant, LOL. Mark Langora, Nicolas Cage, Vampire's Kiss. Angela Jane Nagy, agrees. Good one. Tom Horsball, Isabella Johnny, Possession, Kevin Keegan. Choi Ming Sink in I Saw the Devil. Daniel Detila, Bale in The Machinist, Eric Roberts or Mickey Rourke in Spawn. Ian Isra, Bill Forsythe out of Justice, Jake Criddle, I gotta give it up for Cage and Vampire's Kiss. Nick Mua, once again an intriguing question, sir, if I may give you three, though, they're all from the same movie, namely Graveyard Shift. 1. Brad Dourif as the exterminator suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. 2. Stephen Mott as Warwick, the boss from Hell's Asshole. And 3. Robert Alan Buth as the Ibison, especially his imitation of Warwick, more than enough crazy to fill a cuckoo's nest, pun intended. You'll go on to the Graveyard Shift. Love that movie. Questions. 1. What would you do if your boss from hell gave you the graveyard shift? If I really didn't want to do it, I'd quit and find another job. Name relatively short films that feel very long, like a long one. Ooh, there are some. I should have done some research on that. But somebody just talked about The Prey, so let's go to The Prey. The Prey from 1984. When is the musical? Not this episode. I listened to The Exploding Heads. They talk about The Prey. That's one that feels longer than it should. When is the musical episode of The Mr. Parker Show coming? Have a good one. It's not ever going to happen. The Hills Are Alive. That was my singing talent right there. Stephen McGovern, Anthony Wong in The Untold Story. Agreed. Stephen McGovern also says Joe Spinell and Maniac. Michael Church, Kevin Kenny and Crazy Murder. Good choice. That movie's nuts. Shane Glass, Isabella, Johnny in Possession. Mike Papa, Gary Oldman, and Leon the Professional. Everyone. Angela, Jane Nagney, Nicolas Cage, Mandy in the Wicker Man remake. Daniel Carlson, Jeffrey Combs in The Frighteners. My Body is a Roadmap of Pain. So let's get into the question of this week. So basically, I want you to give me your top 10 horror films of 1980. Now, please list them in order, because I'm going to do a whole list. I don't do more than 10. I'll only count the 10. I'm going to calculate what the listeners' top 10 horror films of 1980 are. Please go off Internet Movie Database, and then I'll make a final list, and we can compare at the end how close you guys are to me, how we differ and stuff like that when we get to this eventually. So please give me your top 10 horror films of 1980. If you want to do 10, I'll do 5. So you guys see what you mean. Your number 1 will count as 10 points. Your number 2 will count as 9 points. And I'll tally the points up and see where they register and everything like that. So anyways, let's get into the update and the Patreon drawing. You know what? I'm going to do the Patreon drawing here because I'm unhinged. And that's what we're doing. I was checking my time on there now. So basically, I'm going to draw 5 names for the Patreon, see where we're at, what movies we'll be watching. This bag is getting fatter and fatter, right? Here we go. John Wilhelm, any Mondo Macabre release not seen? Love it. That's one. Who else do we got? Derek B., Where, which is a werewolf film I've wanted to see forever. Kind of a different kind of one. I probably think I'm cheating. I'm not putting the bag here. What else do we got here? We got Derek B., another. He's got Godzilla, Mothra, and King Ghidorah. So he's got 2 coming out of the bag. That's 3. What we got is number 4. Jason Willard, Knockabout, directed by with Sammo Hung, who I just covered a movie for, so that's cool. Get to see more by him. And the last one coming out of the bag. Get some of these ones from the bottom pulled up. Is going to be Chris Rivers, The Chase, 1966. So there we go. I don't remember if I've seen that one or know which that one is. But anyways, we're going to hop into that update. Okay, let's hop into this update. First up is, Anatomoa Extinction. This is director, I believe, of Meatball Machine. Is that who did it? But this is from the Air 444. This is their first release. Not the special edition. I missed out on that. But anyways, I'm interested to check that one out. Sounded kind of crazy. Then we have their second and third release here. It is the Funky Forest, The First Contact, and the Warped Forest Collection. I'm looking forward to checking this company's stuff out. I know they have some Cat 3 movies coming out. This looks very bizarre and different. They also sent along a picture here with some nudity on it, of course, and a soundtrack for Funky Forest. So very cool. Looks like a nice set there. Bumping the camera, of course, like I always do. Sorry about that. Temperature changes are crazy. Then we have one from 1980. That's right. New Year's Evil, the new Kino release. It's supposed to have a new scan on there. I've never loved this movie, but is there a new scan? I don't know. Maybe I'm just buying the same stuff over and over again like an idiot for a slipcover. I've done dumber, but this is New Year's Evil. I have the Scream Factory. I definitely, if I don't enjoy it this time, I don't think I'll ever like New Year's Evil. One from 1980. We have another one from 1980 released by Kino, re-released from Scream Factory. This is Without Warning, which is kind of a classic movie with Jack Palance and Martin Landau. All sorts of ridiculousness in it. Really done by Graydon Clark. It's kind of a really fun movie, if you haven't noticed. There's a crazy alien in this thing. Precursor to Predator, actually. What else do we have? We have Violent City with Charlie Bronson, Telly Savalas, Jim Ireland. This is by Sergio Soloma, which this is a great movie. I had like a Italian import. So happy to have a stateside release. This is a really cool one of Bronson's best, actually. Probably one of his most underrated, to be honest. Violent City, great stuff. Then we have a new release of Mr. Majestic, a new scan. This is a great Charles Bronson flick. Always liked this one. Got some really memorable lines. He's the watermelon farmer. Just really cool stuff. Nobody's ever seen Mr. Majestic. We got Art Lantira there, who died fairly young. But we got a brand new 2K master of it, so picked it up. I always love ordering from Kino. They always put out lots of cool stuff. Grand Slam. Janet Leigh, Robert Hoffman, Klaus Kinski, Adolfo Ceri. This one, Edward G. Robinson. I believe it's an Italian flick. I had the old DVD. Never did get a chance to watch it. But I love these Italian kind of crime films and everything like that. So looking forward to checking out Grand Slam. Next up, we have The Cursed, which was 8 for silver originally. Went through theaters. Heard good things. Heard only good things about this one, honestly. I felt like my time was going out there. But yeah, so I picked it up, relatively cheap. I guess it's somewhat of a werewolf story. Then we have The Beta Test, which I watched for last year, and I thought it was absolutely wonderful. Not necessarily a horror film, but close enough. Who's the actor in here? It's the same people that did The Wolf of Snow Hollow, Jim Cummings. He stars and he directed this movie. He's brilliant. This is a hilarious movie. Perfect. Next up, we have The Awakening from Scream Factory. This is another 1980 movie. Had an old DVD. Heard this movie was so boring that I never picked it up, but since we're doing 1980, I picked up the Blu-ray. Charlton Heston. It's a mummy. Yeah. So hopefully it's all right. And then next up, we also have Chamber of Horrors from Scream Factory. Didn't have this one. Ended up picking it up. I think I had a DVD of this. I don't think I've ever seen this one here. But yeah, not too familiar with the movie really. But Patrick O'Neill's in there. I think I recognize him from Silent Night. Silent Night, Bloody Night, if I'm not mistaken. Sorry about that, guys. We have some Massacre Video here. We have Hard Gore. Massacre Video order came in. Probably some nudity. No nudity on the back, but this is always pretty crazy movie. Hardcore is hardcore. Come and get it. Love it. Yeah, never seen this one. Going to check it out for sure, obviously. Then we have, what's up next? Here we have Portraits of Andrea Palmer, which is a really good movie. I had the old release, but I picked this one up because I'm a completist for Massacre Video, and it also has short film Flesh Meat Dolls by the same filmmakers, which is a really crazy short. But this movie's weird. This is a strange film, dark kind of porno film. And then up next, we have The Bad Pack, Robert Davi, Roddy Piper, Ralph Muller. This looks like an action kind of thing. It was cheaper to get the whole package. And like I said, I am a collector of the Massacre Video titles. So anyways, I'm looking forward to their other releases, Men Behind the Sun and all that good stuff. So yeah, that's the end of the update. Let's get back to that video. Okay, guys, thank you very much for watching. As always, have a good one. Peace.